Hey guys, welcome back. SCHIZONE episode 13. As usual, we're implementing stuff from scratch in assembly. Topic today is an extremely boring one, and that is floating point I/O. And the motivation for this is because, well, this whole series is about engineering software. That means you're doing math, which means you need numbers. So you have to be able to get numbers into the software. And so that's where floating point I/O comes into play. So this will include string to float conversions, as well as just the basics of character delimited files like CSVs, etc. So actually, I asked Mandy what are some options for getting floating point data into our programs, and she had a few ideas. All of them are good ideas. The first one, option A, we could just hard code all the data into the binary, and this is actually not a bad idea because our code compiles, you know, in quotes, compiles really quickly. It assembles instantly, basically. And so you could even write some kind of a wrapper script that like writes our assembly code with the numbers embedded inside. That's not a terrible idea, to be honest. But yeah, it would get kind of unwieldy if you had a bunch of different things that you wanted to run your software on. You'd have to constantly be changing the binary, which again is not terribly hard to do, but not the easiest way either. Option B would be to prompt the user to enter all the data with the keyboard. And again, that's not a terrible idea because you can actually, you know, automate that if you really wanted to. And you could, as she says, you could actually break apart the integer and fraction parts of it, enter the integer part of this number, enter the fraction part of this number, right? And then you repeat that over and over again. That's a good idea. But again, it comes kind of unwieldy when you have like 1,000 by 1,000 element matrices that you want to, you know, work with. And so, yeah, not really the best, but it's a workable solution. Option C is what we're going to do in this video, and that is to just parse floats from an input file, like a CSV. And what that entails is basically looking at strings and figuring out what those strings mean. Because remember, you know, we read, you know, out of a file, you open up like a file and you see 123.456. You have to remember that that's not a number. That's a sequence of ASCII bytes. This is 7 ASCII bytes in order. This does not mean 123.456. This means some random string of numbers. And so we have to have a function, a program, a routine or whatever that can adapt the string into an actual quantity. And remember, floating point numbers, you know, in our heads, you know, look like this, but in the computer, it looks like this. And so how do you get from a string of ASCII bytes to a hexadecimal string like this? It almost seems crazy. But ideally, we'll do that in this video, and we want to be able to do that for all of these different kinds of combinations of inputs. I have a couple here. So a number like 123, we have to be able to parse that. Even though it's an integer, we have to be able to pull that into a float. And then 123.456, an example of a integer and a fractional part of a number combined. Negative numbers have to be there. Explicitly positive numbers have to be there. Scientific notation, right? E has to be able to be parsed, as well as negative decimals with, you know, positive exponents as well. The whole gambit of scientific, regular, and even whole looking numbers like 123 have to be able to parse by our parse float function. So for that parse float function, it looks like this. This is how I implemented it, at least. It's a function called parse float, and all it does is it returns a floating point number in register XMM0, and it takes one input. And all that input is a pointer to the first character of your string. And what it will do is it will return in XMM0 the value of that parsed character array, which starts at the address in register RDI and terminates at any non-numerical character. Here I say besides decimal point, but also besides E, besides plus, besides minus, any number that you could consider to be numeric in nature. And so this function has to have a lot of steps. And remember, a lot of these steps are optional steps because not all numbers have all these pieces, right? The number 123 doesn't have a negative sign, or a decimal point, or a fractional part, or an exponent, or a sign for the exponent, right? None of those things. So you have to be able to kind of constantly be checking for what do I even need to parse, let alone what am I parsing? And so the couple steps are like this. The first step is to check for a leading sign. Is it going to be a negative number? Is it going to be an explicitly positive number, so +5? Or is it just going to be a regular 5, you know, which is the same thing, but it's written differently. Next would be to parse the whole number part of the number. So in this case, 123, checking for a decimal point, parsing the fractional part, checking for an exponent, checking for a sign in the exponent, parsing the exponent, and then ending at the first invalid byte. So byte besides numbers, besides decimal point, besides e, besides plus, besides minus. And actually, you can't even have a plus, right? You can't have 123.456 e negative 3 plus. That's not a valid number, right? So you have to think, what is it? What is invalid at this point in the number? And that changes, right? Because if the number ends here, different bytes would be considered invalid, right? Anyway, it's a pretty simple process. Let me first specify all the different relevant ASCII values. Remember, these characters are just ASCII values. And so here, maybe two dozen numbers are relevant. You have numbers 0 through 9, which are ASCII values 48 through 57. But you also have little e, lowercase e, which is ASCII value 101. You have plus, which is 43, minus is 45, decimal point is 46. And then maybe for a CSV, you'd care to know that a comma is 44. And then you have other things like slash, which we're not going to use in this video. So the first thing you do is to check for that leading sign. And so remember, RDI, the value in that register is an address that points to the first byte in our number. And the question is, what is this byte? Is this byte a number like 6? Or is it a negative sign, or is it a positive sign? Ideally, it should be one of those three things. If it's not, you have a problem. If it's a W, you have a problem. And so first thing we do is we check, is this number a plus? Is this character a plus, I should say? And so actually, first you can see I have defined R8. This is just gonna be a flag that we're gonna use to track, is this number negative? So if R8 is 0, it's a positive number. If R8 is 1, it's negative. So when you XOR R8 with itself, that means set R8 to 0. And so at the outset of this program, we assume it's a positive number. First thing we do is we compare. You can see here, compare the byte at the address in register RDI with the value 43. 43 corresponds to a plus symbol. And so this comparison says, hey, is our first character a plus? And then jump equal means if it is a plus, jump to this address here, explicitly positive number. That means we've specified that our number is actually positive. In that case, all we're doing is we're incrementing our pointer. So our pointer no longer points to the plus sign. It points to what we hope is the first actual numerical number, like 6. In this case, it would point to the 1 here with this increment RDI instruction. At that point, you go on to the loop, and now we're parsing the integer part of the number. Hopefully. However, if it's not a plus sign, this jump doesn't execute. And so you go to the next instruction, which says compare the byte at the address in register RDI with the quantity 45. That is a minus sign. Here I say jump not equal, so that means if it is not a minus sign, just start the integer parsing. We hope that we're now in a valid numerical quantity, like 6 or 7 or 8, we know that at this point, it's not a negative sign. However, if it is a negative sign, this won't execute, and the computer will move to this instruction, which means inc RD8. That just sets our negative number flag to 1. We increment our pointer to the next byte, and we go on with the code. So this is a very detailed look at a very simple operation. We're just checking if the first character was a negative sign or a positive sign or just some regular number. Okay, The next step was to parse the whole number part. At this point, our pointer points to the first, hopefully, numerical quantity. And I'm not gonna cover error handling like, oh, what if it's a Q? What if it's a, you know, a null byte or something? I'm assuming the alt data we're passing in is valid, and if not, it's just gonna crash anyway, so I don't care to handle errors specifically. In this case, at this point, our pointer points to the first integer number, and we have a loop for this. I will specify as well that outside the loop, we should define some values. Rex is gonna be our kind of accumulator or just our tracker of the number. So we're starting out with Rex as 0. So in this case, our Rex will eventually be 123, but at the beginning it's 0. And RCX is just the multiplier for our base. That's called a radix. And you know, base 10, the radix is 10. So we're gonna just track how our number changes when we add digits to it. For example, let's say the first digit was a 1. You would have to multiply that by 1 by a 10 before you add the next digit. So then you have 12, multiply that by 10, you have 120 before you add the third digit, which is 3. So one, that's how it works, right? So anyway, the loop is like this. First thing you do is you grab the byte at the address in register, RDI, and you zero extend it, which means you make all the leading digits 0, and you put the value in RBX. That's what I'm doing, at least. Then I'm subtracting 48 from that number. What does that do? Well, looking at the ASCII values, let's say that number was a 1, which it was, the ASCII value would be 49. So taking 48 from that would give you the true numerical quantity of 1. So then what you do is imol RCX. What this does, when you don't define the actual register to multiply by, this just multiplies RIX by 10. And so at this point, our RIX was 0. We scale 0 by 10, which is still 0. And then we add to our accumulator the new digit, which was 1. So now RIX has a value of 1. Then what we do is we increment our pointer to now point from the 1 to the 2. And then we check some conditions. In this case, we're checking, hey, is there an exponent coming? Hey, is there a non-numerical quantity coming? Is our number over? Is there a Q coming? Is there a W coming? Is there a comma coming? It will break in that case. Also, we check for non-valid numbers, like a slash symbol, things like that. Or we can check for a decimal point and go to that part of the code as well. But every time we cycle through one of these bytes, one at a time, we have to check what is coming next to know what we're even looking for next. But let's just say it's still a numerical quantity. If it is, if the next number in this case is a 2, then this jump will execute and we will come back to the top. At that case, we're gonna take the 2 value. The 2 value in ASCII is 50. Take 48 from that is a 2. Multiply our RIX, which was 1, by 10. Now we have a 10 in RIX. Add 2 to that, 12. Check the conditions once again, come back to the top. Our next byte is a 3, which is 51 in ASCII. You take 48 from that, that's a 3. Multiply 12, which is our accumulator value, by 10, 120, add 3 to it, 123. At this point, RIX contains 123, which is our integer part. And then these conditions will satisfy, one of them probably will. In this case, the decimal point check will probably satisfy because the next number is a decimal point. What is a decimal point in ASCII? It's 46. So when we compare the byte in RDI with 46, that is checking for a decimal point, which is the next step of our process, and that will satisfy, and we're gonna fall out of this loop. So at this point, we've done this step, and this step. But I will say that most of the next steps are just the same thing, just repeated. Because when we're parsing the fraction, it's no different from parsing an integer, right? We're just parsing three different, well, in this case, three different characters, but it could be n different characters. And it's just an integer. But the difference is, when parsing the fraction, it's the same algorithm as before, but this time your pointer is pointing to the 4 as opposed to pointing to the 1. But the only difference that you have is you have to also track the denominator. So every time that you go one byte, you have to increase your denominator from 1 by a factor of 10. Or say from 10 by a factor of 10. Because the first quantity you have here, 4, it's not actually 4, it's 4 tenths. And when you go to 2 bytes, you have 45 hundredths. And 3 bytes, 456 thousandths. And so you have to keep track of the implied denominator as well. But it's a very simple matter of multiplying by 10 every time. Then, checking for an exponent and a sign, that's the same thing as the whole number thing again. You're just checking for these bytes and then parsing the integer quantity of the exponent. So we've gone through this, it's just this process repeated once again. However, you can't have a decimal point in your exponent, so you know you have to be smart about what you're checking for, what's a valid number that can come in this situation. But yeah, at this point, all the boxes have been checked. We have now been able to parse everything from the sign to the whole number to the decimal or not, to the fractional part, to the exponent, to the sign of the exponent, and hopefully we found all the constituent parts of this quantity. Now it's a matter of putting everything together. And so when you have all these things, let me move myself. You have a sign, a whole number, a fractional part, an implied denominator, an exponent flag for the sign, as well as an exponent, which you can hopefully use later. And so take the sign, for example. That negative sign in our number corresponds with a float value of -1. Our whole number corresponds to a float of that number. You can use the convert instruction to convert whole numbers to floats. The instruction is CVTSI to SD, and that's how you get from a whole number to a float number of that value. Now for the fractional part, remember we've tracked the fraction and we've tracked the implied denominator. In this case, divide the 2 and that's your fraction. Add those together, multiply it by your float, your leading sign flag, and you have a quantity that corresponds to your sign, your whole number part, and your fractional part. Now the exponent comes in. If you have an exponent, you have to consider, well, what was the exponent? In our case, it was a 3, so you have to get a multiplier from that, 10 to the power of 3. Now, because that's 1,000, and because our sign flag was negative, you're dividing by 1,000. If your sign flag was positive, you'd be multiplying by 1,000. Either way, based off all this data, you now know you're taking your combined number, dividing it by 1,000, and here's your resultant. And automatically, if you've done this, using the floating point unit on the computer, it will automatically know it will be using the hexadecimal format for that number for all its computations. And so this is what the computer will see. This is what you'll understand that number to mean. And even though your original number looked like this, it was a series of ASCII bytes, now you successfully have converted that to a floating point number on your computer. Great. It's actually a lot simpler than it would sound. But there is one more step, and that is to pull those numbers from a delimited character file of floats. For example, like a CSV, a TSV, etc. Like this. So here's an example of a CSV where you have numbers like 1.01, comma, -2.02, comma, 3.03. And the delimiter here obviously is the comma. And so we have to implement a function that can begin to parse these floats using the above function from a file. And so it's a little bit more convoluted because you have to go through a buffer to do this, but here's how the function is set up, the way I've written it. It's a function called parse delimited float file, and it doesn't return anything, but it basically takes RDX, which is a number of double precision floating point values from the file descriptor, which you've already opened, hopefully, and pass that value in register RSI, places those in an array that begins at address RDI. That's why it's a pointer to double format. And we use a buffer for that purpose, because we're reading bytes from a file into a buffer of length RCX bytes, starting at address R8, and the delimiter between those floats is a variable. You can make it a semicolon, you can make it a comma, you could make it a new line. Whatever you do, just pass it into the low byte of register R9. So a lot of stuff in there, but simply this just takes an opened file which has the delimiter between floats and parses that into an array. The only caveat, the only complexity here is that you have to, because you're parsing from a file, you're not parsing from, you know, memory, is that you have to know that if you're pulling, you know, 128 bytes or 1024 bytes from a file, it's not going to line up with your delimiter, right? You know, let's say your buffer is size 64, and let's say 64 bytes is, I don't know, somewhere in this 11, right? Let's say this is your 64th byte. So this is byte 0, this is byte 63. Well, you know, you can parse this number and this number and this number all the way around to the 10, but the instant you try to parse 11, it's not a full number anymore because we're missing it. There's no comma. And so you have to know that, hey, this is not a full number. I have to refill the buffer starting at this one and get 64 bytes from there. That's the only complexity in this whole situation, because you can't read from a file. Well, I guess you could, but it's not very efficient to read from a file byte by byte. We're using a buffer to make it more efficient of a read operation. And because of that, you have to kind of have some extra logic in there to make sure that, yeah, everything I'm reading is what I'm intending to be reading the whole time. Hope that makes sense. If not, here's a flowchart. Basically, you're opening the file descriptor and you're reading some number of bytes from that file into a buffer. We call it read buffer. And we're iterating through that buffer, parsing floats. In this case, we'd parse 1.01, then we'd parse -2.02, and we'd parse 3.03, and we repeat that process until there's no longer a delimiter between our current location and the end of the buffer. When that is true, there's no longer a comma in our buffer, we have to read the remainder of, we have to basically copy our end of our buffer to the beginning and read the rest of the buffer bytes from the input file to fill up the buffer once again. And then we keep looping that until we're out of bytes to read. A lot of steps, but it's pretty straightforward. If you look at the code, everything there is commented pretty well. So with that in mind, let's check out the code. I have four different examples today. One is called parse floats. This is just parsing floats from strings. So let's say the user typed in 1.23, hit enter, you could parse that string into a float. Then I have two examples here that take CSVs or similar files and parses floats from those files. And then I have a fourth example, which is just writing a CSV file, which is very straightforward. I'm not gonna even talk about how that works. You just basically write floats in the way we've covered in a previous video with a comma between them. So very straightforward as well. With that in mind, let's look at the code itself. So all of these are in the SOIHUB suppository. You can check it out, example 13. And there's a README. You can check out the README. Let's do really quick all the different things with some just a very brief explanation of how what they're doing. So example A, in this case, we were reading strings. So here you can see I got a bunch of floats, float strings, which are, you know, as you can see, quite simple numbers. We have 123, negative 123, adding decimal points, adding negative signs, exponents, positives, etc. This kind of covers the gambit of different types of floats that you would want to pass into your program. And so what's happening in this program? Well, what are we including? We're including a couple input files, or functions, I should say. One is the parse float function, which I specified in this video, but also print float and print characters, just to dump out our results as we read them. And here's how the process works. Basically, all we're doing is we're passing that pointer to the start address of the float, of the string, which is a float. And then we are calling parse float. This parses that float, starting at the address that we specified, and then puts the value in register XMM0, and then it prints it out with a new line. So it does that for all the floats, all 10 floats that we specified. It parses them and prints them out. So if I compile or assemble and run this, you can see that it successfully parses all those various formats, and so the code functions hopefully as intended. Okay, with that out of the way, let's open up the example B. Example B was just parsing floats from an input file. So if I look, I have a matrix.csv file here. If I open the matrix.csv file, you can see I got those numbers from the slide 1.01, negative 2.02, etc. And we're going to try to read these into an array. That's the idea. So if I open up the code, you can see in this case, we have a read buffer of size 64 bytes. So we're going to be reading 64 bytes at a time from that file, that matrix.csv file, and using our parse delimited float file function, which I just explained, to do so. And then we're going to print it out, obviously, with this print array float function, which we implemented many, many weeks and months ago. So it's very straightforward. All we do is we open the input file, which is very simple. We did this in one of our first videos, opening files. We read the floats from that CSV into an array. I'll show you the array down here at the bottom. The array is it's a 6x4 element float matrix, and so we have to initialize 24 quad words, 24 quad words of space. For that, we have our file name described here as a null terminated string, and we just open that file, read the floats in from the CSV into that array using that function I specified. The delimiter here is a comma. We could change that to a semicolon if we wanted to, if it was a semicolon delimited file, but it's not, it's a CSV. We call that function, and then we print out the array. So if I execute this, you can see that the matrix.csv file is successfully parsed, and all the data is passed into an array, and that array is then printed to the screen. So we can successfully parse a matrix from an input file. Great. Let's go to example C. Now, this example was a little bit different because let me remove the binary really quick. I have two input files here. So I've got a multiply.this and a by.this. As you would expect, let me open up those files. They are just, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. They're both 6, wait, hold on, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9, 9 elements. So we're gonna apply 3x3 matrices. And they just multiply numbers together. This one you can see is a CSV file, whereas this one is a semicolon limited file. Just to show that you can do whatever you want. You could pass in files in whatever format you'd like, and the function still works the same way. And so the idea is we're multiplying those two files by each other, which doesn't make sense, but we're parsing numbers from the files and multiplying those numbers together. And the way it works, let's open up the code and check it out. Again, we have a read buffer of size 64 bytes. How does this work? Let me go to the bottom first. So it looks like we have two different file names, multiply.this and by.this, and we have three different arrays. We have one array to store the first input file data, one array for the second input file data, and then one for the product. And obviously, we're just gonna be including the file open assembly program function, the parse delimited float file function, print array function to print out the results, and also our matrix multiply function to multiply matrices. And so first thing we do is we open input file one, we parse the values from that CSV into array one, that memory location, do the same thing for array two from file name two, then we multiply them together with this matrix multiply function that we wrote a few weeks ago, and then we print out the result to the screen. And so if I run that, you can see it parses those numbers, and you can see we've got numbers like 420, 337, 1776, pi, is that e? What is that? I don't even know what that is. Square root of 2, square root of 3, whatever that, I don't even know what that is. But yeah, this is an intended result. So yeah, the function works as expected. So last example was example 13D. That's not a directory. In this case, we're just writing to a file. Here you can see we've written to the matrix.out function, the file. I'm gonna delete that so we can do it again. Let's open up the code and see what's going on. So I've got a 3x3 element float matrix in memory here. You can see it's just 1.11, 2.22, etc. The idea is simple. We're gonna write this to this file name. And so we have a function that we wrote called print delimited floats. It's very straightforward. You can check out the online suppository for the details of that. We open the input file, we write that array out to the CSV with a common delimiter. Hey, you know what? Let's just change the delimiter just for fun. Let's make it an and sign. Run the code. That will give us a matrix.out file, open matrix.out, and you can see we have all of our data written out in scientific notation with an and in between each floating point number. Why would I do that? I don't know, but we did it anyway. With that, I'll end the video, I think. We covered everything in pretty great detail, perhaps too much detail. It's a very, very boring topic. I'm sorry, Wen, you had to go through this. If you want to hang out, we have a Discord server, link in the description. Hope you guys enjoyed. See you in the next video.